Hare Krishna. Question: is the Bhagavad Gita a secular book? From Rajesh, I heard a spiritual teacher who said that the Bhagavad Gita is a secular book because it is not sectarian. So, is the Bhagavad Gita a religious book or a secular book? Answer: the Bhagavad Gita is a spiritual book. No, the categories secular and religious, these conceptual categories have come recently. Whereas the Bhagavad Gita is an ancient book and its thought system, its philosophy, its worldview, its culture are very profound. And they cannot be retrofitted into current categories of thought such as religious or secular. So now, first of all, now some thinkers some teachers may say that the Bhagavad Gita is a secular book because the idea of secularism is popular in today's world. And if anything is considered secular, then it is accepted. So therefore, the Bhagavad Gita, some people may call the Bhagavad Gita as secular. So now let's understand what the Bhagavad Gita stand is. So first of all, are secular and religious necessarily opposite? That itself is necessarily a misunderstanding, because secular is not non-religious or anti-religious. Secular simply means not partial to any religion. So to say that something has to be secular or religious, that is not a proper categorization in itself. So the Bhagavad Gita, secular in general, when people say that something is secular, what they are trying to say is that we are non-sectarian, we are broad-minded. So for example, one Sikh leader, he said that Sikhism is a secular religion. Now what exactly does that mean? He was basically trying to appropriate the appeal of secularism for his own religion. So now, what does secularism mean? As I said, in general, it means separation, the government, the state will not be partial to any particular religion. So that requirement is there because the government is partial. Even today in Islamic states, many Islamic states, not all, when the government has a particular religion, often they don't allow any religion to be practiced, other religion to be practiced, or they allow it to be practiced only in privacy, not in public. So this sort of theocratic states, which are intolerant, are what modern historical memory is familiar with. And because of that, people feel that we don't want such autocratic theocracies, and therefore better to have secularism. So the Bhagavad Gita talks about a different kind of state, where the state is concerned about people's spiritual welfare, but at the same time the state also respects people's free will to choose according to their faith. So the Bhagavad Gita demonstrates both. It demonstrates how the king is a Rajarishi. Arjuna was a Rajarishi, and the Bhagavad Gita itself describes this knowledge is given to Rajarishis. There are kings who also have spiritual vision. Raja is a ruler, Rishi is a seer. So Rajarishi means a seer ruler, a person who has spiritual vision. So that means the Bhagavad Gita does recommend that the king have spiritual vision, king practice spirituality and keep people on the path of spiritual growth. But that does not mean that the king imposes it. The king encourages it, the king facilitates it, but the king respects the free will. That is seen in both the Bhagavad Gita itself, Vimrishchaitada Sheshina Ithechisita Thakuru. In 18.63, towards the end, Krishna tells Arjuna, now you deliberate and you decide. But when Krishna says deliberate and decide, Krishna first provides the knowledge by which people can deliberate, and then there can be decision. So if there is no knowledge only, then how can people make a well-informed decision? So in today's secular world, today's notion of secularism, there is no knowledge provided at all. So when no knowledge is provided at all, then actually people take a decision not after deliberation but without consideration, and often people take the easiest path. The easiest path often is the path of materialism and quick sense gratification, and thus they stay in spiritual ignorance. So rather than apathy towards religion, there can be this Bhagavad Gita offers not this kind of ignorance for people, but provide spiritual education, and then lets people make their choices. So this of the spirit of the Bhagavad Gita is also seen in the culture in which it was added. In the Bhagavad Gita is spoken in the context of the Mahabharata, and the Mahabharata features many kings many of whom were of different denominations. So there were kings who worshipped the devatas, there were sages at those times who were of different orientations. The Bhagavad Gita and the Mahabharata is quite respectful towards them also. So in general, is the Bhagavad Gita a non-sectarian book? Yes, it is non-sectarian in the sense that it talks about universal truths. It does not talk about sectarian ideas that, okay, our way is the only way, as do many of the sectarian religions of the world. The Bhagavad Gita talks, Prabhupada would say that Bhagavad Gita is science. You know, now we can scientifically analyze whether we are not the body or whether we are the souls. And now we cannot scientifically pursue who is God. Not scientifically with our method of science, but we can understand that there is a higher being, and that by devoting ourselves to that higher being, we can get higher happiness. This is some, and yoga is a process by which we can experience higher happiness. So if we put aside the things that we think are sectarian, oh, you people worship Krishna, oh, people you chant Hare Krishna, but if instead of that we focus on the principles that are underlined over there, that the universal principle that there is a higher reality, and that higher reality can be accessed by a universal process. So if we see that way, then the Bhagavad Gita is non-sectarian, it is universal. The Bhagavad Gita doesn't say that its message is only for a particular group of people. The Bhagavad Gita itself doesn't contain the word Hindu, nor does it contain condemnation of any other religions. So the Bhagavad Gita in that sense is inclusive, it is non-sectarian, it is universal. Now we may think that it seems sectarian because we try to reduce the transcendental to the cultural or the historical or the sociological. When we try to fit the Bhagavad Gita into a particular conceptual category, then we are reducing the transcendental to a mundane level. So trying to reduce the Bhagavad Gita to secular or religious, that also is a reduction of the transcendental wisdom of the Gita. Rather than trying to impose our conceptual categories on the Gita, if we open ourselves to the wisdom of the Gita and see what it says, then we will find that it talks about universal truths which essentially agree with the fundamental truths of the great religions of the world, and which essentially help all people everywhere to make sense of life, to find, add value to life, and to find happiness in life. So in that way, the Bhagavad Gita is a book which can benefit all of humanity. Thank you. Hare Krishna.